The Philippines and the United States seek to identify five additional sites for projects under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, or EDCA. This is to allow forces from both countries to respond more quickly to disasters and crises that may happen in the Philippines. Now, to tell us more about this, we are now joined by Mr. Jose Antonio Custodio, defense analyst and military historian. Mr. Custodio, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you clearly, sir. Now, five more sites added to the five original that both countries have already agreed upon. But since it started in, I think that's 2014, 8 years ago, they've only completed just one. Now, what's taking so long? Is the U.S. dragging its feet on this? If it is, why?
Why? Well, it's taking so long because it's from the same guy who shut the ABS-CBN down, you know, none other than Duterte, you know. So it's because of the Duterte administration that things just slowed down or even stopped, you know, because he threw a monkey wrench on Philippine-U.S. relations with all his dramatics and theatrics, you know. So he's chumming up with China, you know. So things that were supposed to be, because we were running out of time already as early as the Aquino administration in with regard to China's aggressive acts, and EDCA was one of those measures that was done to strengthen Philippine-U.S. military-to-military relations to better respond to threats coming, let's say, exactly from China. And, of course, the natural disasters that we always have, you know. Mm-hmm. But when Duterte came into office in 2016, you know, voted by people who were misled by his promises, you know, and his bombast, you know, we ended up with an alliance that was in the doldrums, you know. What was affected, you know, the EDCA was affected, Balikatan was affected, mm-hmm. even the last few years of his term, he even stopped the Americans from participating in our HADR, you know, in our own in rescue operations and humanitarian assistance operations in the Philippines, precisely because he just didn't like them, you know. And what happened was that it overstretched the Philippine military, you know. Our assets were strained because we were responding to one disaster after the other. That's why in the last 2 years especially during the pandemic, Panaman, mm-hmm. you would see that the Philippine Air Force was plagued by a number of mishaps, precisely because the crews were all overstretched, you know.
Now that we have a new administration, do you think it's moving fast enough? Well, it's only been a couple of months for the Marcos administration, but are you expecting it to move faster than before?
Oh yeah, there's a lot of optimism that it would move fast, you know, because Americans are encouraged by what they hear from the new administration. It is proving to be receptive to American initiatives. And basically, the Philippine-U.S. military alliance rests on U.S. initiatives, actually. You know, we are more of the reactive player. Unfortunately, the only time that we decided to have some form of initiative was when Duterte started, doing all that stupidity on the alliance, you know. Mm-hmm. But now, you know, things are back on track again. So, let's see what happens, you know. If the additional sites are identified as important for the conduct and projection of alliance assets in this part of Southeast Asia.
And this talk of five more additional sites is a good sign that it is moving. It is somehow moving.
Well, it is moving. Yeah, mm-hmm. it despite all the indecisiveness on our side of the alliance, it's still moving.
Mr. Custodio, we've heard from another analyst, Greg Poling, who's saying that the EDCA is extremely important and extremely important that it is rapidly implemented. Do you agree with this assertion?
Yeah, it's rapidly implemented precisely because of the fact that it's all overdue already. Mm. What would be implemented now should have been implemented 5 years ago, again, because of the... antics of Duterte. You know, that's why we're in this situation where Greg Pauling has to say that it has to be done now. Eh? Because, for example, in a few days ago, we saw these pictures of reconnaissance pictures of the Chinese improving on their artificial islands in the West Philippine Sea area. So right. we see that there is a need, you know, to address that. Plus the fact that right now we have a typhoon, you know, in the Philippines.
Yes, right. You mentioned China. Speaking of China, China and ASEAN are now working on the second draft on the code of conduct for the South China Sea. Does that seem like good news to you?
Well, of course, we know China's up to no good always, you know. So this thing is just that they're just trying to mislead the rest of the world, saying that okay, we're doing this. It's only good for propaganda for China. But at the end of the day, they're not going to follow it, you know. They're still going to do that outrageous and illegal territorial claim that they're doing, that the entire South China Sea is theirs and it's non-negotiable. So, that thing is like some sort of feel-good thing that they're doing, you know. So at the end of the day, we still have to remain vigilant, you know. We still have to prepare ourselves for acts of Chinese aggression in the future, you know, especially as they build up their activities. You see, I mean, they talk about China says that it's going to talk with ASEAN on the code of conduct, but at the same time, it's still harassing ASEAN states in this region, and at the same time, it is also strengthening and improving on its military installations.
So are really, you saying that any code of conduct that can be agreed upon won't be beneficial for us?
Well, it will be beneficial for us because we can always slap it on China's face and tell China, see, you're not following what you're saying, you know? But at the end of the day, we still also have to back up that slap with some form of capabilities, you know? And that's where the alliance system comes in, you know, where ASEAN also, you have a number of members of ASEAN who are also receptive to the presence of more powerful partners in the region to address to push back against China's duplicitous behavior.
And even with a code of conduct, we still have to watch our back.
Yes, yes, exactly. You have to watch our back. You know, there are a lot of people or interests with bad intent there in this world right now. Philippines, yes.
Do you think there will come a point when we have to choose between allowing more U.S. troops into the Philippines and agreeing to a code of conduct?
Well, no. Actually, those things are they complement each other, you know. Because, like I said, the code of conduct its value is that it makes ASEAN move as one, you know. But the partner, the countries here would move as one, would cooperate, you know, in order to present a document that will show to China that this is what good behavior is, what is, you know. And at the same time, like I said, while you're doing that, then we also engage in strengthening our alliance, our partnerships with not just the United States. We have Japan, we have Australia, we have even India, you know, bring them all in here, you know, make the Chinese pay for every inch of territory that they are illegally occupying.
Defense analyst Jose Antonio Custodio, thank you very much for talking to us, sir.
Thank you very much also.